terms of a relationship with Four and the other characters here.
The first movie was about Triss sort of following Four.
Yeah.
Insurgent sort of seemed like Four was following Triss, trying to stop her from her impulsive nature. And in this movie, we thought it would be lovely to create a balance of the two.
How would you describe David as a character? Who is this guy?
He's actually a good guy. I mean, maybe he ends up doing some things that fall on the bad guy end, but he wants to help people. He wants to save humanity.
Of course, importance of the Divergent saga is the hair on the set. Who do you think has the best hair?
Well, I think I have pretty, like, crazy different hair.
You do.
I do, right?
Originality.
It's not very,
definitely.
Right, yeah. I do. But it's hot underneath here. It's really warm.
I like Jeff Daniels' hair. Yeah. And he has, it's gray now and it's a buzz cut.
Right.
I'm like, yeah, I like
distinguished,
that.
But a little younger.
Distinguished is new.
Yeah.
Go, Jeff.
Theo has the best hair. He's Greek, and he has this thick, curly hair, and I think there's something really, really great about that.
I don't know. I think it's hard to say. Yeah. What? I'm just thinking about who has the best hair on set.
There's been a lot of attention around Shailene's hair in every movie, so I don't want to...
Hers keeps getting shorter. She changes the color a little bit, but I think you go with what's been there the whole time.
You think that you have the best hair of the cast?
Oh, come on, Josh, you read the book.
The threat of anyone exercising their independent will. This is what allows us to live in peace. Divergence threatened that system.
And if I had to be placed in a faction in real life, maybe enmity. They chill. They're all about love and compassion. I don't know, I think I'd be too scared to join Dauntless. That's some real stuff. How does this film compare to Hunger Games? I mean, it has this, you know, it's the same kind of genre of film, I suppose. It has leading ladies, young, brave, beautiful leading ladies that are being kind of thrown from one world to the other. But it's its own thing, you know, it's a completely different story. And but I like that people seem to be really responding well to these stories of young, strong women. I think that needs to happen more and more in this industry, so it's exciting.
This movie or series of movies will be seen very much as the same genre as The Hunger Games, which is no bad thing. I mean, hitting that that demographic where the everyday life and the things around them, the decisions they're making, this rites of passage, this growing effect is life-shattering and world-changing. And, you know, I think it hits all those points. It'll be compared, I hope, favorably, and I hope not compared as the same movie, because it's not, it's completely different, but the human the human condition and the questions raised and answered are the same.
My character's name is Triss, Beatrice Pryor, and she is a normal 18-year-old who has a very strong heart and a very opinionated nature, but has grown up in a faction where the trait of selflessness pervades, and she decides throughout the film to switch into another faction that is dedicated to bravery and courage and protection of a city, and so she has to leave behind her selfless roots. What she finds is that she can't. Her decisions are constantly being torn between whether to be brave or whether to be selfless. If I were to be placed in one of these factions, I think I'd be Divergent. I think I'm similar to Triss in just the fact that my personal beliefs, you can't stereotype one human being as one thing or another. I would be a cross between the hippie plant tree hugging amities and the dauntless, because I think that, you know, there are important issues in the world that we need to be paying attention to and that we need to be shedding light upon, and probably candor. Yep.
The coolest part about shooting in Chicago would have to be the deep dish pizza. It's really good. But no, it's my first time in Chicago. I lived in New York for a couple years, and it's nice being in a city. There's a lot of heart in Chicago. I think people are really proud of their city, so you can feel that, I think, when you tell people you're shooting here. Well, we have a really good cast. I think, you know, whenever you have a Kate Winslet and Shailene and a great director and Neil, good producers, I think everybody's going about it the right way. And yeah, from what I've seen, from what I've done so far, it seems like we're making something really honest and
Thank you. steps before he punches. Okay? Go.
Points for bravery, Stiff. But not as many as you just lost for opening your mouth. Watch yourself. We're training soldiers here, not rebels. All right, we're done. Get out.
Three, two, one, action! Action!
You guys good? You okay? All right, let's go. All right, there's a net at the bottom. Don't think.
What was this?
Don't think, okay? Just jump.
Got it. That was very authentic. Okay, let's go again.
Right. Let's go again right away.
Ask you anything more about?
I made a mistake. Choosing Dauntless. They'll find out.
Who will?
The people you're a threat to.
What people? Dauntless?
The whole society. You can't fit into a category. They can't control you.
Well, that's a good thing,
I don't want to be controlled. That's exactly what I mean. You don't listen to them. You don't fall in line. It's the problem with being what you are.
Like, none of this makes any sense to me at all. But I'm dauntless. I chose dauntless. I'm going to be dauntless.
For your sake, I hope so.
See, Mark?
It isn't. It's engineering go in there.
How do we get past those guards?
We don't. We either wait for them to leave or find another way in. Are you sure?
Like you said, there's not a second to waste.
It's very intimidating, too. Everything is so detailed, and everything, you know, is made with so much love, and it's insane. It's very intimidating, so, and that makes me just, you know, even happier and even more proud that I can be a part of something like that. I remember when I met Shailene the first day, she like walked towards me and just hugged me right away and be like, very welcoming. That was really nice. Because you are nervous in the beginning when you join a big set and big team like that. You are like, I said that before, like when you go to high school the first day and you want to be, you sit with the cool kids at the same table. So yeah, they were really nice. People want to escape when they want to watch, when they go to the theater. They just want to be in a different world and get maybe distracted for a little bit from their own life and whatever's going on. And this is such a great movie for that, because you really can lose yourself in this world. And I mean, Shailene and Theo fighting for not just them, I mean, but you know, them fighting for
war against abnegation. But everyone still has a choice of how they go about their lives, and she is a faction leader and still chooses to be a pacifist in a way and not engage in any of the turmoil. Now the war is pretty much at her front door, so there are no factions, and it's very interesting to watch how those who are used to being in charge have to adjust, and Johanna is one of those people. Johanna is reacting to Evelyn's assumption of power. Publicly, she has a face. I don't think she's really I think she's being diplomatic publicly because she wants to show solidarity. But at the same time, she also knows that Evelyn is exhibiting the same type of dictator qualities or mentality that Janine possessed. So while publicly she is hoping for the best, privately she's preparing for the worst. Triss and Four are important pieces to the puzzle to Johanna because they were there when the Dauntless attacked Abnegation, and they emerged as warriors. And in the fight during Insurgent, when the Divergents were being sought out and killed, they emerged as leaders and people that others deferred to. So their youth and their agility and their status as Divergents made them both warriors, but people who also assumed responsibility in a way that heroes should. And Johanna also understands that people want to follow people that they believe in. And if you have Triss and Four on your team, then
breaking down. It's a completely different organism. You know, it has its own political leaders. It has it's a full-blown running society. And I think when Triss and Four enter, they're a little bit hesitant of it, and yet also very keen on the luxuries that come with a world that's not war-torn and come with a world that's functioning and has access to things that they didn't have access to in Chicago. The pure are people who are genetically pure, meaning that their genes have not been altered by scientists in a lab. And the damaged are people whose genes, whether it was from their direct parents or their ancestors, their genes have been manipulated by genetic engineering. This movie is interesting because Triss and Four both go their own directions, and they're very much sort of out of contact and out of communication with one another. Triss is up in the bureau with David, and Four is on the floor in the fringe with the military of the bureau. And they both see different sides of who this David person is, and that creates distance between them because Four has one idea and Triss has another idea, and they can't seem to come to an agreement. The new cast, it was really exciting. I had a lot of scenes with Bill Skarsgård, who's incredibly talented, and he has sort of this really great old soul, classic way about him for being so young, and Nadia Hilker, who's very mysterious and beautiful and incredibly talented as well, and then Andy Bean, who plays Ramit, who's sort of, you can't quite tell any of these new characters whether they're good or guys or bad guys, whether they're antagonists or protagonists. And then Jeff Daniels, who plays David, his character is quite mysterious as well because you don't really know what he's vying for, like what drives his vision and what drives his purpose. Audiences can expect just as much action.
I feel like Chicago has reached a place where it can't come back from, and the insanity is continuing with these executions. So they're going to leave, and they're going to see what's outside the wall because they've seen this message. So they set out a plan to do so, and it's quite a complex one. But they have to get over the wall, and you know, people don't want them to leave. Let's just say so. It's and then it begins a whole complex sequence, and they leave the city, and they discover what's outside of Chicago. You know, it's difficult because not only is it a physical wall that they have to, I mean, it's quite impressive when you see it. It's a humongous wall, and they have no idea what is outside. But also logistically, they have to get over it, and they have accomplices, you know, other characters in the story. But it's also symbolic, you know, it's leaving everything that they know with very little to help them along the way. It's a wasteland. It's obviously a place that has suffered some kind of chemical warfare. And it appears that there is nothing there. So suddenly they feel like they have kind of gone down a rabbit hole that they can't return from. And then suddenly the Bureau opens up, and it's a completely different world beyond any of their expectations. David's played by Jeff Daniels, and he is this new, quiet but charismatic presence in their lives, and he is essentially the kind of leader or the person who runs the Bureau. Four is inherently a little, you know, pessimistic, a little critical of him. You know, he looks around and he sees another form of control. You know, he's someone who's grown up in that very much so, and he's been damaged by it at all stages of his life. And again, that's his personality. He's more someone who is measured and a little bit, you know, he's not going to jump on the train quite so easily, whereas Triss is very hopeful, and she feels like this is what she's been searching for, and this is the kind of the missing piece to her questioning for all her life, so she's quite abrasive of it. Some of the fun of the movie is discovering this new world and discovering a new technology. And Four has a chance to use some of the weapons that they have and they're able to use. And he's quite impressed by them. And being, you know, a kind of a good consummate soldier, I guess, he has a chance to kind of revel in that in quite a fun way. I think their biggest challenge now.
Chris and Four and Tori, there was a knowing kind of connection between the four of them where, you know, they really knew they had to get out because things were looking bad. You know, anytime you give the power to the people when the people aren't organized and thoughtful in what they want or don't even have the skill to know how to, you know, make the right decisions to lead the people in the right direction, you can't really trust that setting. And they knew that right away. And I think they were all on the same page. So it was a sort of unanimous, unspoken thing where it's like, we have to get out before this boils over. It's interesting how you have to have so many different scales of a set to on a movie like this. You know, it's so big. And I think that, you know, as you were saying, the literal and the metaphorical sort of way out has to be grand in nature. You know, you can't sort of face the biggest thing that you need to do in your life, which is get out, and it just be like a little molehill that you sort of skip over, right? It has to actually have physical scale, and it has to loom over you sort of the way the thought of it, and as we were saying, the metaphorical idea of actually getting out looms over you.
And he references, like, Caleb. He says Caleb's an example of that. And but Triss, you're not. You're pure. You're genetically pure. Come to me. We're gonna turn everybody into just like you, and the whole world, we're gonna save the world. We've saved a city. Now help me save a world. A lot of the direction that Robert's been thrown at me is he makes him more human. You know, you can get lost in this and go robot with it or something. And he really is great about, you know, you're feeling this and he's thinking that, the emotion is there, and it really humanizing David that I think is great. It's really going to pay off. On one hand, it's a futuristic movie, it's science fiction, you got a great protagonist in Shailene Woodley's character, but on another level, it's representative of too much interference, too much whether it's government or whether it's people not just genetically altering you, but altering you. And I think we're, I think if people, when they're seeing this, can make the connection that, you know, I get it politically. You run on this, you run on that, but don't tell me how to live. Don't change me to fit what you want me to be. And I think that's a big...
Points for bravery, Stiff. But not as many as you just lost for opening your mouth. Watch yourself. We're training soldiers here, not rebels. All right, we're done. Get out.
Action!
You guys good? You okay? All right, let's go. All right, there's a net at the bottom. Don't think. Don't think, okay? Just jump.
Got it. That was very authentic. Okay, let's go again.
Right. Let's go again right away.
Do we have-
ask you anything more about?
I made a mistake. Choosing Dauntless. They'll find out.
Who will?
The people you're a threat to.
What people? Dauntless?
The whole society. You can't fit into a category. They can't control you.
Well, that's a good thing. I don't want to be controlled.
That's exactly what I mean. You don't listen to them. You don't fall in line.
None of this makes any sense to me at all. I'm Dauntless. I chose Dauntless. I'm going to be Dauntless.
For your sake, I hope so.
See, Mark?
It isn't. It's engineering going there.
How do we get past those guards?
We don't. Either wait for them to leave or find another way in. Are you sure?
Like you said, there's not a second to waste.
It's very intimidating, too. I mean, everything is so detailed, and everything, you know, is made with so much love, and it's insane. It's very intimidating, so, and that makes me just, you know, even happier and even more proud that I can be a part of something like that. I remember when I met Shailene the first day, she like walked towards me and just hugged me right away and be like, very welcoming. That was really nice. Because you are nervous in the beginning when you join a big set and big team like that. You are like, I said that before, like when you go to high school the first day and you want to be, you sit with the cool kids at the same table. So yeah, they were really nice. People want to escape when they want to watch, when they go to the theater. They just want to be in a different world and get maybe distracted for a little bit from their own life and whatever's going on. And this is such a great movie for that, because you really can lose yourself in this world. And I mean, Shailene and Theo fighting for not just them, I mean, but you know, them fighting for
war against abnegation. But everyone still has a choice of how they go about their lives, and she is a faction leader and still chooses to be a pacifist in a way and not engage in any of the turmoil. Now the war is pretty much at her front door, so there are no factions, and it's very interesting to watch how those who are used to being in charge have to adjust, and Johanna is one of those people. Johanna is reacting to Evelyn's assumption of power. Publicly, she has a face. I don't think she's really. I think she's being diplomatic publicly because she wants to show solidarity. But at the same time, she also knows that Evelyn is exhibiting the same type of dictator qualities or mentality that Janine possessed. So while publicly she is hoping for the best, privately she's preparing for the worst. Triss and Four are important pieces to the puzzle to Johanna because they were there when the Dauntless attacked in Divergent, attacked Abnegation, and they emerged as warriors. And in the fight during Insurgent, when the Divergents were being sought out and killed, they emerged as leaders and people that others deferred to. So their youth and their agility and their status as Divergents made them both warriors, but people who also assumed responsibility in a way that heroes should. And Johanna also understands that people want to follow people that they believe in. And if you have Triss and Four on your team, then
breaking down. It's a completely different organism. You know, it has its own political leaders. It has it's a full-blown running society. And I think when Triss and Four enter, they're a little bit hesitant of it and yet also very keen on the luxuries that come with a world that's not war-torn and come with a world that's functioning and has access to things that they didn't have access to in Chicago. The pure are people who are genetically pure, meaning that their genes have not been altered by scientists in a lab. And the damaged are people whose genes, whether it was from their direct parents or their ancestors, their genes have been manipulated by genetic engineering. This movie is interesting because Triss and Four both go their own directions, and they're very much sort of out of contact and out of communication with one another. Triss is up in the bureau with David, and Four is on the floor in the fringe with the military of the bureau. And they both see different sides of who this David person is, and that creates distance between them because Four has one idea and Triss has another idea, and they can't seem to come to an agreement. The new cast, it was really exciting. I had a lot of scenes with Bill Skarsgård, who's incredibly talented, and he has sort of this really great old soul, classic way about him for being so young, and Nadia Hilker, who's very mysterious and beautiful and incredibly talented as well, and then Andy Bean, who plays Ramit, who's sort of, you can't quite tell any of these new characters whether they're good or guys or bad guys, whether they're an antagonist or protagonist. And then Jeff Daniels, who plays David, his character is quite mysterious as well because you don't really know what he's vying for, like what drives his vision and what drives his purpose. Audiences can expect just as much action.
I feel like Chicago has reached a place where it can't come back from, and the insanity is continuing with these executions. So they're going to leave, and they're going to see what's outside the wall because they've seen this message. So they set out a plan to do so, and it's quite a complex one. But they have to get over the wall, and you know, people don't want them to leave. Let's just say so. It's and then it begins a whole complex sequence, and they leave the city, and they discover what's outside of Chicago. You know, it's difficult because not only is it a physical wall that they have to, I mean, it's quite impressive when you see it. It's a humongous wall, and they have no idea what is outside. But also logistically, they have to get over it. And they have accomplices, you know, other characters in the story. But it's also symbolic, you know, it's leaving everything that they know with very little to help them along the way. It's a wasteland. It's obviously a place that has suffered some kind of chemical warfare. And it appears that there is nothing there. So suddenly they feel like they have kind of gone down a rabbit hole that they can't return from. And then suddenly the Bureau opens up and it's a completely different world beyond any of their expectations. David's played by Jeff Daniels, and he is this new, quiet but charismatic presence in their lives, and he is essentially the kind of leader or the person who runs the Bureau. Four is inherently a little, you know, pessimistic, a little critical of him. You know, he looks around and he sees another form of control. You know, he's someone who's grown up in that very much so, and he's been damaged by it at all stages of his life. And again, that's his personality. He's more someone who is measured and a little bit, you know, he's not going to jump on the train quite so easily, whereas Triss is very hopeful, and she feels like this is what she's been searching for, and this is the kind of the missing piece to her questioning for all her life, so she's quite embracive of it. Some of the fun of the movie is discovering this new world and discovering a new technology. And Four has a chance to use some of the weapons that they have and they're able to use. And he's quite impressed by them. And being, you know, a kind of a good consummate soldier, I guess, he has a chance to kind of revel in that in quite a fun way. I think their biggest challenge now.
Chris and Four and Tori, there was a knowing kind of connection between the four of them where, you know, they really knew they had to get out because things were looking bad. You know, anytime you give the power to the people when the people aren't organized and thoughtful in what they want or don't even have the skill to know how to, you know, make the right decisions to lead the people in the right direction, you can't really trust that setting. And they knew that right away. And I think they were all on the same page. So it was a sort of unanimous, unspoken thing where it's like, we have to get out before this boils over. It's interesting how you have to have so many different scales of a set to on a movie like this. You know, it's so big. And I think that, you know, as you were saying, the literal and the metaphorical sort of way out has to be grand in nature. You know, you can't sort of face the biggest thing that you need to do in your life, which is get out, and it just be like a little molehill that you sort of skip over, right? It has to actually have physical scale, and it has to loom over you, sort of the way the thought of it, and as we were saying, the metaphorical idea of actually getting out looms over you.
And he references like Caleb. He says Caleb's an example of that. And but Triss, you're not. You're pure. You're genetically pure. Come to me. We're gonna turn everybody into just like you, and the whole world. We're gonna save the world. We've saved a city. Now help me save a world. A lot of the direction that Robert's been thrown at me is he makes him more human. You know, you can get lost in this and go robot with it or something. And he really is great about, you know, you're feeling this and he's thinking that, the emotion is there, and it really humanizing David that I think is great. It's really going to pay off. On one hand, it's a futuristic movie, it's science fiction, you got a great protagonist in Shailene Woodley's character, but on another level, it's representative of too much interference, too much, whether it's government or whether it's people not just genetically altering you, but altering you. And I think if people, when they're seeing this, can make the connection that, you know, I get it politically. You run on this, you run on that, but don't tell me how to live. Don't change me to fit what you want me to be. And I think that's a big...
Before he punches. Okay? Go.
Points for bravery, Stiff. But not as many as you just lost for opening your mouth. Watch yourself. We're training soldiers here, not rebels. All right, we're done. Get out.
Action!
You guys good? You okay? All right, let's go. All right, there's a net at the bottom. Don't think.
What was this?
Don't think, okay? Just jump.
Okay.
Cut.
Cut.
That was very authentic. Okay, let's go again.
Right. Let's go again right away.
Ask you anything more about?
I made a mistake. Choosing Douglas. They'll find out.
Who will?
The people you're a threat to.
What people? Douglas?
The whole society. You can't fit into a category. They can't control you.
Well, that's a good thing. I don't want to be controlled.
That's exactly what I mean. You don't listen to them. You don't fall in line.
Like, none of this makes any sense to me at all. But I'm Dauntless. I chose Dauntless. I'm going to be Dauntless.
For your sake, I hope so.
See, Mark?
That's it, isn't it? It's engineering going there.
How do we get past those guards?
We don't. Either wait for them to leave or find another way in. Are you sure?
Like you said, there's not a second to waste.
It's very intimidating too. I mean, everything is so detailed and everything, you know, is made with so much love, and it's insane. It's very intimidating. So, and that makes me just, you know, even happier and even more proud that I can be a part of something like that. I remember when I met Shailene the first day, she like walked towards me and just hugged me right away and be like, very welcoming. That was really nice. Because you are nervous in the beginning when you join a big set and big team like that. You are like, I said that before, like when you go to high school the first day and you want to be, you sit with the cool kids at the same table. So yeah, they were really nice. People want to escape when they want to watch, when they go to the theater. They just want to be in a different world and get maybe distracted for a little bit from their own life and whatever's going on. And this is such a great movie for that, because you really can lose yourself in this world. And I mean, Shailene and Theo fighting for not just them, I mean, but, you know, them fighting for
war against abnegation. But everyone still has a choice of how they go about their lives, and she is a faction leader and still chooses to be a pacifist in a way and not engage in any of the turmoil. Now, the war is pretty much at her front door, so there are no factions, and it's very interesting to watch how those who are used to being in charge have to adjust, and Johanna is one of those people. Johanna is reacting to Evelyn's assumption of power. Publicly, she has a face. I don't think she's really... I think she's being diplomatic publicly because she wants to show solidarity. But at the same time, she also knows that Evelyn is exhibiting the same type of dictator qualities or mentality that Janine possessed. So while publicly she is hoping for the best, privately she's preparing for the worst. Triss and Four are important pieces to the puzzle to Johanna because they were there when the Dauntless attacked in Divergent, attacked Abnegation, and they emerged as warriors. And in the fight during Insurgent, when the Divergents were being sought out and killed, they emerged as leaders and people that others deferred to. So their youth and their agility and their status as Divergents made them both warriors, but people who also assumed responsibility in a way that heroes should. And Johanna also understands that people want to follow people that they believe in. And if you have Triss and Four on your team, then
breaking down. It's a completely different organism. You know, it has its own political leaders. It has it's a full-blown running society. And I think when Triss and Four enter, they're a little bit hesitant of it, and yet also very keen on the luxuries that come with a world that's not war-torn and come with a world that's functioning and has access to things that they didn't have access to in Chicago. The pure are people who are genetically pure, meaning that their genes have not been altered by scientists in a lab. And the damaged are people whose genes, whether it was from their direct parents or their ancestors, their genes have been manipulated by genetic engineering. This movie is interesting because Triss and Four both go their own directions, and they're very much sort of out of contact and out of communication with one another. Triss is up in the bureau with David, and Four is on the floor in the fringe with the military of the bureau. And they both see different sides of who this David person is, and that creates distance between them because Four has one idea and Triss has another idea, and they can't seem to come to an agreement. The new cast, it was really exciting. I had a lot of scenes with Bill Skarsgård, who's incredibly talented, and he has sort of this really great old soul, classic way about him for being so young, and Nadia Hilker, who's very mysterious and beautiful and incredibly talented as well, and then Andy Bean, who plays Ramit, who's sort of, you can't quite tell any of these new characters whether they're good or guys or bad guys, whether they're antagonists or protagonists. And then Jeff Daniels, who plays David, his character is quite mysterious as well because you don't really know what he's vying for, like what drives his vision and what drives his purpose. audiences can expect just as much action.
Feel like Chicago has reached a place where it can't come back from, and the insanity is continuing with these executions. So they're going to leave, and they're going to see what's outside the wall because they've seen this message. So they set out a plan to do so, and it's quite a complex one. But they have to get over the wall, and you know, people don't want them to leave. Let's just say so. It's and then it begins a whole complex sequence, and they leave the city, and they discover what's outside of Chicago. You know, it's difficult because not only is it a physical wall that they have to, I mean, it's quite impressive when you see it. It's a humongous wall, and they have no idea what is outside. But also logistically, they have to get over it, and they have accomplices, you know, other characters in the story. But it's also symbolic, you know, it's leaving everything that they know with very little to help them along the way. It's a wasteland. It's obviously a place that has suffered some kind of chemical warfare. And it appears that there is nothing there. So suddenly they feel like they have kind of gone down a rabbit hole that they can't return from. And then suddenly the bureau opens up and it's a completely different world beyond any of their expectations. David's played by Jeff Daniels, and he is this new, quiet but charismatic presence in their lives, and he is essentially the kind of leader or the person who runs the bureau. Four is inherently a little, you know, pessimistic, a little critical of him. You know, he looks around and he sees another form of control. You know, he's someone who's grown up in that very much so, and he's been damaged by it at all stages of his life. And again, that's his personality. He's more someone who is measured and a little bit, you know, he's not going to jump on the train quite so easily, whereas Triss is very hopeful, and she feels like this is what she's been searching for, and this is the kind of the missing piece to her questioning for all her life. So she's quite embracive of it. Some of the fun of the movie is discovering this new world and discovering a new technology. And Four has a chance to use some of the weapons that they have and they're able to use, and he's quite impressed by them. And being, you know, a kind of a good consummate soldier, I guess, he has a chance to kind of revel in that in quite a fun way. I think their biggest challenge now.
Chris and Four and Tori, there was a knowing kind of connection between the four of them where, you know, they really knew they had to get out because things were looking bad. You know, anytime you give the power to the people when the people aren't organized and thoughtful in what they want or don't even have the skill to know how to, you know, make the right decisions to lead the people in the right direction, you can't really trust that setting. And they knew that right away. And I think they were all on the same page. So it was a sort of unanimous, unspoken thing where it's like, we have to get out before this boils over. It's interesting how you have to have so many different scales of a set to on a movie like this. You know, it's so big. And I think that, you know, as you were saying, the literal and the metaphorical sort of way out has to be grand in nature. You know, you can't sort of face the biggest thing that you need to do in your life, which is get out, and it just be like a little molehill that you sort of skip over, right? It has to actually have physical scale, and it has to loom over you sort of the way the thought of it, and as we were saying, the metaphorical idea of actually getting out looms over you.
And he references, like, Caleb. He says Caleb's an example of that. And, but Triss, you're not. You're pure. You're genetically pure. Come to me. We're gonna turn everybody into just like you, and the whole world, we're gonna save the world. We've saved a city. Now help me save a world. A lot of the direction that Robert's been thrown at me is he makes him more human. You know, you can get lost in this and go robot with it or something. And he really is great about, you know, you're feeling this and he's thinking that, the emotion is there, and it really humanizing David that I think is great. It's really going to pay off. On one hand, you've got, it's a futuristic movie, it's science fiction, you got a great protagonist in Shailene Woodley's character, but on another level, it's representative of too much interference, too much, whether it's government or whether it's people, not just genetically altering you, but altering you, and I think if people, when they're seeing this, can make the connection that, you know, I get it politically. You run on this, you run on that, but don't tell me how to live. Don't change me to fit what you want me to be. And I think that's a big...
Before he punches. Okay? Go.
Points for bravery, Stiff. But not as many as you just lost for opening your mouth. Watch yourself. We're training soldiers here, not rebels. All right, we're done. Get out.
Action! Action!
You guys good? You okay? All right, let's go. All right, there's a net at the bottom. Don't think. Don't think, okay? Just jump.
Got it. That was very authentic. Okay, let's go again.
Right. Let's go again right away.
A good thing. I don't want to be controlled.
That's exactly what I mean. You don't listen to them. You don't fall in line. It's a problem with being what you are.
Like, none of this makes any sense to me at all. But I'm dauntless. I chose dauntless. I'm going to be dauntless.
See, Mark.
I can go, you know, like, right. Be with myself. I can just break this like no one.
That's it, isn't it? It's engineering.
How do we get past those guards?
We don't. Either wait for them to leave or find another way in. Are you sure?
Like you said, there's not a second to waste.
It's very intimidating, too. I mean, everything is so detailed, and everything, you know, is made with so much love, and it's insane. It's very intimidating, so, and that makes me just, you know, even happier and even more proud that I can be a part of something like that. I remember when I met Shailene the first day, she like walked towards me and just hugged me right away and be like, very welcoming. That was really nice. Because you are nervous in the beginning when you join a big set and big team like that. You are like, I said that before, like when you go to high school the first day and you want to be, you sit with the cool kids at the same table. So yeah, they were really nice. people want to escape when they want to watch, when they go to the theater. They just want to be in a different world and get maybe distracted for a little bit from their own life and whatever's going on. And this is such a great movie for that, because you really can lose yourself in this world. And I mean, Shailene and Theo fighting for not just them, I mean, but, you know, them fighting for
war against abnegation. But everyone still has a choice of how they go about their lives. And she is a faction leader and still chooses to be a pacifist in a way and not engage in any of the turmoil. Now, the war is pretty much at her front door. So there are no factions. And it's very interesting to watch how those who are used to being in charge have to adjust. And Johanna is one of those people. Johanna is reacting to Evelyn's assumption of power. Publicly, she has a face. I don't think she's really... I think she's being diplomatic publicly because she wants to show solidarity. But at the same time, she also knows that Evelyn is exhibiting the same type of dictator qualities or mentality that Janine possessed. So while publicly she is hoping for the best, privately she's preparing for the worst. Tristan Four are important pieces to the puzzle to Johanna, because they were there when the Dauntless attacked in Divergent, attacked Abnegation, and they emerged as warriors. And in the fight during Insurgent, when the Divergents were being sought out and killed, they emerged as leaders and people that others deferred to. So their youth and their agility and their status as Divergents made them both warriors, but people who also assumed responsibility in a way that heroes should. And Johanna also understands that people want to follow people that they believe in. And if you have Tristan Four on your team, then
breaking down. It's a completely different organism, you know. It has its own political leaders. It has it's a full-blown running society. And I think when Tristan Four enter, they're a little bit hesitant of it, and yet also very keen on the luxuries that come with a world that's not war-torn, and come with a world that's functioning and has access to things that they didn't have access to in Chicago. The pure are people who are genetically pure, meaning that their genes have not been altered by scientists in a lab. And the damaged are people whose genes, whether it was from their direct parents or their ancestors, their genes have been manipulated by genetic engineering. This movie is interesting because Tristan Four both go their own directions, and they're very much sort of out of contact and out of communication with one another. Triss is up in the bureau with David, and Four is on the floor in the fringe with the military of the bureau. And they both see different sides of who this David person is, and that creates distance between them because Four has one idea and Triss has another idea, and they can't seem to come to an agreement. The new cast, it was really exciting. I had a lot of scenes with Bill Skarsgård, who's incredibly talented, and he has sort of this really great old soul, classic way about him for being so young. And Nadia Hilker, who's very mysterious and beautiful and incredibly talented as well. And then Andy Bean, who plays Ramit, who's sort of, you can't quite tell any of these new characters whether they're good or guys or bad guys, whether they're an antagonist or protagonist. And then Jeff Daniels, who plays David, his character is quite mysterious as well, because you don't really know what he's vying for, like what drives his vision and what drives his purpose. Audiences can expect just as much action.
I feel like Chicago has reached a place where it can't come back from, and the insanity is continuing with these executions. So they're going to leave, and they're going to see what's outside the wall, because they've seen this message. So they set out a plan to do so, and it's quite a complex one. But they have to get over the wall, and you know, people don't want them to leave. Let's just say so. It's and then it begins a whole complex sequence, and they leave the city, and they discover what's outside of Chicago. You know, it's difficult, because not only is it a physical wall that they have to, I mean, it's quite impressive when you see it. It's a humongous wall, and they have no idea what is outside. But also logistically, they have to get over it. And they have accomplices, you know, other characters in the story. But it's also symbolic, you know, it's leaving everything that they know with very little to help them along the way. It's a wasteland. It's obviously a place that has suffered some kind of chemical warfare. And it appears that there is nothing there. So suddenly they feel like they have kind of gone down a rabbit hole that they can't return from. And then suddenly the bureau opens up, and it's a completely different world beyond any of their expectations. David's played by Jeff Daniels, and he is this new, quiet but charismatic presence in their lives, and he is essentially the kind of leader, or the person who runs the bureau. Four is inherently a little, you know, pessimistic, a little critical of him. You know, he looks around and he sees another form of control. You know, he's someone who's grown up in that very much so, and he's been damaged by it at all stages of his life. And again, that's his personality. He's more someone who is measured and a little bit, you know, he's not going to jump on the train quite so easily, whereas Triss is very hopeful, and she feels like this is what she's been searching for, and this is the kind of the missing piece to her questioning for all her life, so she's quite embracive of it. Some of the fun of the movie is discovering this new world and discovering a new technology. And Four has a chance to use some of the weapons that they have and they're able to use, and he's quite impressed by them. And being, you know, a kind of a good, a consummate soldier, I guess, he has a chance to kind of revel in that in quite a fun way. I think their biggest challenge now.
Chris and Four and Tori, there was a knowing kind of connection between the four of them where, you know, they really knew they had to get out because things were looking bad. You know, anytime you give the power to the people when the people aren't organized and thoughtful in what they want or don't even have the skill to know how to, you know, make the right decisions to lead the people in the right direction, you can't really trust that setting. And they knew that right away, and I think they were all on the same page. So it was a sort of unanimous, unspoken thing where it's like, we have to get out before this boils over. It's interesting how you have to have so many different scales of a set to on a movie like this. You know, it's so big, and I think that, you know, as you were saying, the literal and the metaphorical sort of way out has to be grand in nature. You know, you can't sort of You can't sort of face the biggest thing that you need to do in your life, which is get out, and it just be like a little molehill that you sort of skip over, right? It has to actually have physical scale, and it has to loom over you sort of the way the thought of it, and as we were saying, the metaphorical idea of actually getting out looms over you.
And he references, like, Caleb. He says Caleb's an example of that. And but Tris, you're not. You're pure. You're genetically pure. Come to me. We're gonna turn everybody into just like you, and the whole world. We're gonna save the world. We've saved a city. Now help me save a world. A lot of the direction that Robert's been thrown at me is he makes him more human. You know, you can get lost in this and go robot with it or something. And he really is great about, you know, you're feeling this and he's thinking that, the emotion is there, and it really humanizing David that I think is great. It's really going to pay off. On one hand, it's a futuristic movie, it's science fiction, you got a great protagonist in Shailene Woodley's character, but on another level, it's representative of too much interference, too much, whether it's government or whether it's people, not just genetically altering you, but altering you. And I think if people, when they're seeing this, can make the connection that, you know, I get it politically. You run on this, you run on that, but don't tell me how to live. Don't change me to fit what you want me to be. And I think that's a big...
Theo!
Three, two, one, action. Action!
You guys good? You okay? All right, let's go. All right, there's a net at the bottom. Don't think. Don't think, okay? Just jump.
Cut. Cut. That was very authentic. Okay, let's go again.
Right. Let's go again right away.
Ask you anything more about?
I made a mistake. Choosing Dauntless. They'll find out.
Who will?
The people you're a threat to.
What people? Dauntless?
The whole society. You can't fit into a category. They can't control you.
Well, that's a good thing. I don't want to be controlled.
That's exactly what I mean. You don't listen to them. You don't fall in line.
None of this makes any sense to me at all. I'm Dauntless. I chose Dauntless. I'm going to be Dauntless.
For your sake, I hope so.
See, Mark?
That's it, isn't it? I've seen Janine go in there.
How do we get past those guards?
We don't. Either wait for them to leave or find another way in. Are you sure?
Like you said, there's not a second to waste.
It's very intimidating, too. Everything is so detailed, and everything, you know, is made with so much love, and it's insane. It's very intimidating, so, and that makes me just, you know, even happier and even more proud that I can be a part of something like that. I remember when I met Shailene the first day, she like walked towards me and just hugged me right away and be like very welcoming. That was really nice, because you are nervous in the beginning when you join a big set and big team like that. You are like, I said that before, like when you go to high school the first day and you want to be, you sit with the cool kids at the same table. So yeah, they were really nice. People want to escape when they want to watch, when they go to the theater. They just want to be in a different world and get maybe distracted for a little bit from their own life and whatever's going on. And this is such a great movie for that, because you really can lose yourself in this world. And I mean, Shailene and Theo fighting for not just them, I mean, but you know, them fighting for
war against abnegation. But everyone still has a choice of how they go about their lives, and she is a faction leader and still chooses to be a pacifist in a way and not engage in any of the turmoil. Now, the war is pretty much at her front door, so there are no factions, and it's very interesting to watch how those who are used to being in charge have to adjust, and Johanna is one of those people. Johanna is reacting to Evelyn's assumption of power. Publicly, she has a face. I don't think she's really... I think she's being diplomatic publicly because she wants to show solidarity. But at the same time, she also knows that Evelyn is exhibiting the same type of dictator qualities or mentality that Janine possessed. So while publicly she is hoping for the best, privately she's preparing for the worst. Tristan IV are important pieces to the puzzle to Johanna because they were there when the Dauntless attacked in Divergent, attacked Abnegation, and they emerged as warriors. And in the fight during Insurgent, when the Divergents were being sought out and killed, they emerged as leaders and people that others deferred to. So their youth and their agility and their status as Divergents made them both warriors, but people who also assumed responsibility in a way that heroes should. And Johanna also understands that people want to follow people that they believe in. And if you have Tristan IV on your team, then...
breaking down. It's a completely different organism. You know, it has its own political leaders. It has it's a full-blown running society. And I think when Tristan IV enter, they're a little bit hesitant of it and yet also very keen on the luxuries that come with a world that's not war-torn and come with a world that's functioning and has access to things that they didn't have access to in Chicago. The pure are people who are genetically pure, meaning that their genes have not been altered by scientists in a lab. And the damaged are people whose genes, whether it was from their direct parents or their ancestors, their genes have been manipulated by genetic engineering. This movie is interesting because Tristan IV both go their own directions, and they're very much sort of out of contact and out of communication with one another. Triss is up in the bureau with David, and IV is on the floor in the fringe with the military of the bureau. And they both see different sides of who this David person is, and that creates distance between them because IV has one idea and Triss has another idea, and they can't seem to come to an agreement. The new cast, it was really exciting. I had a lot of scenes with Bill Skarsgård, who's incredibly talented, and he has sort of this really great old soul, classic way about him for being so young. And Nadia Hilker, who's very mysterious and beautiful and incredibly talented as well. And then Andy Bean, who plays Ramit, who's sort of, you can't quite tell any of these new characters whether they're good or guys or bad guys, whether they're an antagonist or protagonist. And then Jeff Daniels, who plays David, his character is quite mysterious as well because you don't really know what he's vying for, like what drives his vision and what drives his purpose. Audiences can expect just as much action.
Feel like Chicago has reached a place where it can't come back from, and the insanity is continuing with these executions. So they're going to leave, and they're going to see what's outside the wall because they've seen this message. So they set out a plan to do so, and it's quite a complex one. But they have to get over the wall, and you know, people don't want them to leave. Let's just say so. It's and then it begins a whole complex sequence, and they leave the city and they discover what's outside of Chicago. You know, it's difficult because not only is it a physical wall that they have to, I mean, it's quite impressive when you see it. It's a humongous wall, and they have no idea what is outside. But also logistically, they have to get over it. And they have accomplices, you know, other characters in the story. But it's also symbolic, you know, it's leaving everything that they know with very little to help them along the way. It's a wasteland. It's obviously a place that has suffered some kind of chemical warfare. And it appears that there is nothing there. So suddenly they feel like they have kind of gone down a rabbit hole that they can't return from. And then suddenly the bureau opens up and it's a completely different world beyond any of their expectations. David's played by Jeff Daniels, and he is this new, quiet but charismatic presence in their lives, and he is essentially the kind of leader or the person who runs the bureau. Four is inherently a little, you know, pessimistic, a little critical of him. You know, he looks around and he sees another form of control. You know, he's someone who's grown up in that very much so, and he's been damaged by it at all stages of his life. And again, that's his personality. He's more someone who is measured and a little bit, you know, he's not going to jump on the train quite so easily, whereas Triss is very hopeful, and she feels like this is what she's been searching for, and this is the kind of the missing piece to her questioning for all her life, so she's quite embracive of it. Some of the fun of the movie is discovering this new world and discovering a new technology. And Four has a chance to use some of the weapons that they have and they're able to use. And he's quite impressed by them. And being, you know, a kind of a good, a consummate soldier, I guess, he has a chance to kind of revel in that in quite a fun way. I think their biggest challenge now.
Chris and Four and Tori, there was a knowing kind of connection between the four of them where, you know, they really knew they had to get out because things were looking bad. You know, anytime you give the power to the people when the people aren't organized and thoughtful in what they want or don't even have the skill to know how to, you know, make the right decisions to lead the people in the right direction, you can't really trust that setting. And they knew that right away. And I think they were all on the same page. So it was a sort of unanimous, unspoken thing where it's like, we have to get out before this boils over. It's interesting how you have to have so many different scales of a set to on a movie like this. You know, it's so big. And I think that, you know, as you were saying, the literal and the metaphorical sort of way out has to be grand in nature. You know, you can't sort of face the biggest thing that you need to do in your life, which is get out, and it just be like a little molehill that you sort of skip over, right? It has to actually have physical scale, and it has to loom over you sort of the way the thought of it, and as we were saying, the metaphorical idea of actually getting out looms over you.
And he references, like, Caleb. He says Caleb's an example of that. And but Triss, you're not. You're pure. You're genetically pure. Come to me. We're gonna turn everybody into just like you, and the whole world, we're gonna save the world. We've saved a city. Now help me save a world. lot of the direction that Robert's been thrown at me is he makes him more human. You know, you can get lost in this and go robot with it or something. And he really is great about, you know, you're feeling this and he's thinking that, the emotion is there, and it really humanizing David that I think is great. It's really going to pay off. On one hand, you've got, it's a futuristic movie, it's science fiction, you got a great protagonist in Shailene Woodley's character, but on another level, it's representative of too much interference, too much, whether it's government or whether it's people not just genetically altering you, but altering you. And I think if people, when they're seeing this, can make the connection that, you know, I get it politically. You run on this, you run on that, but don't tell me how to live. Don't change me to fit what you want me to be. And I think that's a big